السلام عليك زين الأنبياء السلام عليك.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، حمدا يوافي نعمه ويكافئ مزيده. اللهم لك الحمد حتى ترضى، ولك الحمد إذا رضيت، ولك الحمد بعد الرضا. سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم على سيدنا محمد الفاتح لما أغلق، والخاتم لما سبق، ناصر الحق بالحق، والهادي إلى صراطك المستقيم، وعلى آله وصحبه حق قدره ومقداره العظيم. اللهم نوينا التعلم والتعليم والتذكر والتذكير والنفع والانتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة والحث على التمسك بكتاب الله وسنة رسوله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم، والدعاء إلى الهدى والدلالة على الخير، والدعاء إلى الهدى والدلالة على الخير ابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته وقربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Alhamdulillah, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we praise Him for this opportunity to gather together. This is the largest gathering, the weekend retreat gathering that we've had for over a year and a half now. It was February 2020 that we had book 36, and that was kind of a large open weekend retreat with many people, alhamdulillah. And then after that, we had to go online, and then gradually growing with each weekend retreat, having more and more numbers, and now we're back to a semblance of normalcy. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as inshallah we enter into this new phase, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it a phase of openings, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants all of us and humanity and our loved ones a return to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's very fitting that this weekend retreat that we're able to come together in person and still continue online, that we're focusing on the prayer. And that this is something that we need, every single one of us needs, and every single one of us needs to be reminded of for the rest of our lives. This is a process, this is a journey that we continue to refine and perfect and work at, never really reaching a degree of perfection that any servant, a true servant of Allah, would ever be pleased with, but always trying to draw closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and have a deeper appreciation for the gift of the salah, for the salah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored us with, and this door that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has opened for us by the blessing of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So just on behalf of Sheikh Yahya and all of us, I want to welcome you all back, many familiar faces and many new faces. For the familiar faces, welcome back, and for the new faces, we're very happy to have you, and we hope inshallah that this is the first of many visits and that we continue to learn together and grow together for the rest of our lives, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gathers us with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam in the hereafter, in the highest firdaus, fi khayrin wa lutfin wa afiya. So to begin, inshallah, in this session, this opening session, we're going to look at the merit of the obligatory prayers, the merit of the congregational prayer, salatul jama'ah, and the merit of prayer in the mosque. So what we're looking at in this session is beginning with understanding some of the outward dimensions and aspects of the salah that are very important, and that we don't really say are separate from the inward realities, but both have to be established properly so that we can gain the full benefit and properly establish the salah. So in this session, we're going to look at some of the outward aspects, and even when we recall and study these ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam, they all point us towards the inward realities. So we'll begin with Imam al-Ghazali's introduction to book number 4, the book Kitab Asrar al-Salah. He says, "Praise belongs to Allah who envelops His servants with His kindnesses, بِلَطَائِفِهِ and fills their hearts with the lights of deen, of this religion and its aspects of worship, whose descent in this religion by degrees of mercy from the throne of His Majesty to the heaven of this world is one portion of His infinite compassion. And then Imam al-Ghazali explains that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tells us that Allah calls out every night, is there anyone who calls on me that I might answer? Is there anyone who seeks forgiveness so that I may forgive them? And then Imam al-Ghazali says something really beautiful here. And we have to think about this time and time again. If this is the first time we hear it, inshallah, it's the first of hundreds, if not thousands of times that we think about this meaning and this lesson. وَبَايَنَ الصَّلَاطِينَ بِفَتْحِ الْبَابِ وَرَفْعِ الْحِجَابِ And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unlike the sultans, the earthly rulers. He opens the door and raises the veil. You want to see one of the rulers of the world, you want to see someone who just has a very small amount of nisbi, created power and authority that Allah gives them that is very small and limited. You know, you have to go through so many aspects of red tape and talk to this person and the other person and they're too busy for you. And in most cases, most people who want to see them will never even get to see them. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbul Izzah, the Lord of Majesty, the King of Kings, Jalla Jalalu, He opens the door and lifts the veil. نعم. فَرَخَّصَ لِلْعِبَادِ فِي الْمُنَاجَاتِ بِالصَّلَوَاتِ كَيْفَمَا تَقَلَّبَتْ بِهِمُ الْحَالَاتِ فِي الْجَمَاعَاتِ وَالْخَلَوَاتِ And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows His servants to speak to Him through prayer in whatever situation they might be in congregation and in seclusion alone by themselves. Whenever you want to open the door between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we can even say that, but really when you enter into the salah, you are standing in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are granted access and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hears your prayers and answers you and elevates you and honors you and brings you closer. And the sultans of the world, the rulers of the world, we won't ever get that. And they don't even really have any power or ability. But the one who has all power and ability, subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has given us this gift. And He has allowed for us to enter into His presence, Jalla Jalalu. And then Imam al-Ghazali says, وَالصَّلَاةُ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ نَبِيِّهِ الْمُصْطَفَى وَوَلِيِّهِ الْمُجْتَبَى وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَأَصْحَابِهِ مَفَاتِيحِ الْهُدَى وَمَصَابِيحِ الدُّجَى وَسَلَّمَ تَسْلِيمًا And may Allah's peace and blessings be upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, His chosen prophet and His elect one that He has taken care of all of His affairs and upon His family and His companions, the keys that open the doors of guidance and the lights that guide the way. May Allah send abundant peace upon them. Now we have to understand a very important aspect of the salah, and Shaykh Yahya is definitely going to focus on this, as will Sayyid Tarif, inshallah, in his session, is that when we enter into the salah, whenever we pray, we have to understand that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he is Sayyidu Sajideen. He is the foremost and the preeminent of all who bow and prostrate before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who taught us how to pray. He is the Imam al-Mursaleen, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, when all of the prophets and messengers were gathered. And these are Allah's most beloved creation. These are the most elevated and honored of creation, Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, Prophet Musa alayhi salam, Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, Prophet Isa alayhi salam, Prophet Idris alayhi salam, ajma'in, the greatest. If we saw one of them, we would probably be overwhelmed by the intensity and the majesty of their state with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest of creation. When they see the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he is their imam and he is our imam. sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. This is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we send blessings upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and we talk about the salah, in our mind's eye, in our imagination, we should try to really imagine that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is leading us in the salah. That he is the imam of all who pray. He is the imam of the entire ummah, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Yes, we have the imam that we follow, Sayyid Abdul Fattah, or whoever it may be when we prayed Salatul Maghrib. But we should imagine that, what would it be like if we were standing behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, that when we enter into Allah's presence, subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is the imam of Hadrat al-Quds, the presence of holiness, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Then Imam al-Ghazali tells us something beautiful. Amma ba'd, to proceed and to get into the topic of this particular book from the Ihya. فَإِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ عِمَادُ الدِّينِ, that the prayer is the pillar of the entire religion. And without that imad, everything crumbles. It is the pillar of the entire religion. All of our religious experience, all of what we do in order to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the pillar that holds all of that up is the salah. وَعِصَامُ الْيَقِينِ, and it is the preservation, the way that certitude is preserved and held onto. وَرَأْسُ الْقُرُبَاتِ, and it is the pinnacle of all things that draw one closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَغُرَّةُ الطَّاعَاتِ, and it is the radiance of all acts of obedience. The salah is the most important, as Shaykh Yahya was saying earlier in Salat al-Jum'ah, that after أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, after the two testimonies of faith, there is nothing more important than the salah. And this is what the ummah needs. This is what we really need to revive in our homes, in our communities, in across the entire ummah. That we need to be people who truly are connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that when our prayer is rectified, all other things become rectified. People are looking for solutions in all different kinds of places. Oh, this politician is going to solve all my problems. Oh, this particular ideology is going to solve all my problems. If I just get a lot of money, it's going to solve all my problems. If I just get this person's attention, it's going to solve all of my problems. And all of these things are veils. When we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we establish what He has made an obligation upon us, that is the door that opens all the ways of alleviation and relief and success in this life, and more importantly, in the akhirah. So the salah is that important. And we intend, inshallah, and we pray and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that myself included, and all of us, that what we learn from Imam al-Ghazali, we are able to put that into practice. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala transforms our states from a state of distance to one of nearness, of heedlessness to remembrance, of disobedience to obedience and servitude. Ya arham ar-rahimeen. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spreads the benefit to the entire ummah of His beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. So now we'll look at Fadilatul Maktuba, the merit of the obligatory prayers. قال الله تعالى, Allah the Exalted says, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا, that truly the prayer is set at appointed times for the believers, that it is decreed upon them to be prayed at appointed times set by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which means that this is something to be taken very seriously, that Allah Jalla Jalalu has set these times and we need to observe them in order to fulfill the reality of our iman and servitude. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam said, خَمْسُ صَلَوَاتٍ كَتَبَهُنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْعِبَادِ فَمَنْ جَاءَ بِهِنَّ وَلَمْ يُضَيِّعْ مِنْهُنَّ شَيْئًا إِسْتِخْفَافًا بِحَقِّهِنْ كَانَ لَهُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَهْدٌ أَنْ يُدْخِلَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed five prayers upon the servants, upon His creation. So whoever observes them and establishes them without neglecting any of the aspects that need to be established, thinking little of them, then he has an oath from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he will enter that person into paradise. وَمَنْ لَمْ يَأْتِ بِهِنْ فَلَيْسَ لَهُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَهَدٍ. And whoever does not establish these five prayers, he has no oath from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's no covenant between him and Allah jalla jalalu. إِنْ شَاءَ عَذَّبَهُ وَإِنْ شَاءَ أَدْخَلَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. If Allah wills, he will punish him. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. May Allah protect us from that. And if Allah wills, he will enter him into paradise and forgive him for that. That's not something that we take lightly. In another beautiful hadith, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَثَلُ الصَّلَوَاتِ الْخَمْسِ كَمَثَلِ نَهْرٍ عَذْبٍ غَمْرٍ بِبَابِ أَحَدِكُمْ يَقْتَحِمُ فِيهِ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ خَمْسَ مَرَّاتٍ فَمَا تَرَوْنَ ذَلِكَ يُبْقِي مِنْ دَرَنِهِ قَالُوا لَا شَيْءٍ. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the likeness, the similitude of the five prayers is like a man who has a sweet and flowing river at his doorstep. You open the door, it's right there. And that he washes himself five times in this sweet, flowing, beautiful river. Would that man have any trace of uncleanliness, of dirt on him? And they said, of course not. There wouldn't be anything left. So then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَإِنَّ الصَّلَوَاتِ الْخَمْسَ تُذْهِبُ الذُّنُوبَ كَمَا يُذْهِبُ الْمَاءُ الدَّرَنِ. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the five prayers, they remove sins, just like water removes impurities and filth and dirt. So this prayer, the Salatul Maghrib that we just prayed, inshallah, if we established it properly and we had presence of heart, it's a purification. It increases one in nur. It increases one in nearness to Allah. It removes the veils between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should look forward to Salatul Isha. That's another opportunity to be granted entrance into Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's presence, to turn over our worries, our concerns, our hopes and aspirations, our dreams, to turn them over to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to present and ask from the most generous, that if he gave us everything we ever asked for, if he gave all of creation from the beginning of time to the end of time, all that they ever asked for, it wouldn't decrease from what he has, not even in the slightest bit. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we ask, we should know that we're asking from one who is most generous, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that it purifies us and cleanses us. And it's a beautiful gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in another salah, in another hadith, inna salawati al-khams كَفَّارَاتٌ لِمَا بَيْنَهُنَّ مَجْتُنِبَتِ الْكَبَائِرِ. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the five daily prayers, they are expiations for what occur between them of sins, as long as a person avoids major sins. Those are things that we have to repent for specifically, but in terms of the minor sins, it removes them just like that sweet flowing river. Another hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَ الْمُنَافِقِينَ شُهُودُ الْعَتَمَةِ وَالصُّبْحِ لَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَهُمَا. The difference between us and the hypocrites is attending the Isha and Subh prayers, the Fajr prayer, they're not able to pray them. أَثْقَلُ الصَّلَاةِ عَلَى الْمُنَافِقِينَ صَلَاةُ الْعِشَاءِ وَصَلَاةُ الْفَجْرِ. The heaviest of the prayers on the hypocrites are Salatul Isha and Salatul Fajr. وَلَوْ يَعْلَمُونَ مَا فِيهَا لَأَتَوْهُمَا وَلَوْ حَبْوَا. If they knew what Allah gave people in those two prayers, they would come to them even if they had to crawl. If we knew what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving of gifts, of openings, of anwar, of reward in the hereafter, of answering prayers, of relieving us of difficulties and removing difficulties that might have been coming our way, but through the salah, Allah removed it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We would come to it even if we had to crawl. Naam. وَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَمَ مَنْ لَقِيَ اللَّهُ وَهُوَ مُضَيِّعٌ لِلصَّلَاةِ لَمْ يَعْبَئِ اللَّهُ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ حَسَنَاتِهِ. نَسْأَلَ اللَّهُ الْعَافِيَةِ. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever meets Allah and had not established the prayer, did not care for the prayer, just let the prayers go by haphazardly and lost the opportunity, Allah does not care what else he has of good deeds. Allah has no concern for any of his other good deeds. And as Shaykh Yahya was saying in Salatul Jum'ah, that when a person's prayer is sound, then everything else is sound. When their salah is not sound, then everything else is rejected. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and guide us. وَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الصَّلَاةُ عِمَادُ الدِّينِ. This is what Imam al-Ghazali said in the introduction, that the prayer is the pillar of the religion. So whoever leaves it, they have destroyed the religion. They have just demolished their own foundation of their deen. He was once asked, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, what are the most virtuous of actions? He said, as-salatu limawaqitiha, praying on time, praying the prayer in its appointed time, and especially preferably at the earlier time, and praying in congregation and so forth. In another hadith, he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whoever safeguards the five prayers and performs them with complete purification and in their appointed times, that will be a light and a proof for him on the day of resurrection. It'll be a light and a proof that there will be people on the day of resurrection who will just have a particular nur. It will be known that they were people of salah. It will be known that they are people of wudu. And he says, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, and whoever leaves it aside and does not safeguard it, that person will be resurrected with Fir'aun and Haman. Those are people we don't want to be close to, anywhere near on the day of resurrection. We want to be with Imam al-Mursaleen, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, our Imam in this life and in the hereafter. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam also said, مِفْتَاحُ الْجَنَّةِ الصَّلَاةِ, the key to paradise is the prayer. The key to paradise is the prayer. And he also said, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not make any act, an obligation more beloved to him than the salah. That in other words, there is no other obligatory act more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the salah. And if there was something more beloved to him, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, then he would have made it the ibadah of his angels. So the angels in the heavenly realm, there are some angels who are in a state of ruku' from the day that Allah created them everlastingly, they are in ruku', witnessing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's majesty and his exaltedness. There are some angels that are in sujood, and there are some angels that are standing like we stand when we recite Quran. There are some angels sitting like we sit between the two sajdatain. So, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took all of these different aspects that the angels, when they worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they just have one movement. They have one position. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala combined all of those noble positions and made it the form of prayer for us, so that we have all of the acts of the ibadah of the malaika in our salah. He also said, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, whoever leaves aside the prayer on purpose, muta'ammidan, purposefully, intentionally, faqad kafar, then that person has disbelieved. Nas'al Allah al-afiyah. We never want to leave the sphere of iman. We never, for even a moment, ever want to be outside of the sphere of Allah's mercy. Not even for a moment. And we don't want to do anything that might bring us even closer to the edge. And Imam al-Ghazali says, what does this mean? فَقَدْ كَفَرْ, that he has disbelieved. It means that this person has come close to the point where iman will be stripped from him because he has lost the handhold of iman and its pillar, which is the salah. He also said, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, warning us of the danger of leaving the salah, مَنْ تَرَكَ صَلَاةً مُتَعَمِّدًا فَقَدْ بَرِئَ مِنْ ذِمَّةِ مُحَمَّدٍ. He said, صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم, whoever leaves aside and abandons the prayer on purpose, then he removes himself from the protection of Muhammad. صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. يوم يفر المرء من أخيه وأمه وأبيه وصاحبته وبنيه. On the day when a person will run away from his own mother and father, his own brother and friend, his own children, people will all run away from each other out of the fear. On a day that makes children's hair go gray, on a day where people are so overwhelmed with fear that it's as if they are intoxicated, but they're not intoxicated. How could we ever leave dhimmat Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? How could we ever leave the protection of our Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? On the day when he says, Ana laha, I am the one who will intercede, ummati, ummati, and those close to him, and those who fulfilled, had iman and fulfilled the covenants that they took with him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they will be in a station of success and honor and nobility. They will be on pulpits made of light, and they will be given crowns made of light, and all of these beautiful ways that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will honor those who followed the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. Whoever leaves the salah on purpose removes himself from the protection of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from ever leaving the prayer and from ever being expelled from the protection of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. In another, some of the ulama have said, مثل المصلي مثل التاجر الذي لا يخلص له الربح حتى يخلص له رأس المال. The person who prays is like a businessman, someone who is trading in commerce, that he doesn't get a profit until he gets back his initial investment. وكذلك المصلي لا تقبل له نافلة حتى يؤدي الفريضة. And likewise, with the person who prays, his voluntary supererogatory prayers will not be accepted until he establishes and fulfills the obligation. So we have to fulfill that obligation and realize that the salah is the ra'sul mal, that our investment, in order to be successful and not make a loss, we have to establish the salah. وكان أبو بكر رضي الله عنه يقول إذا حضرت الصلاة قوموا إلى ناركم التي أوقدتموها فأطفئوها. He would say, reminding people of the hereafter, in order to get up and pray, he would say, rise and put out the fire that you ignited for yourself, that you lit for yourselves through sins and so forth. But through the salah, you extinguish that fire. The salah, that fire is extinguished, and you're back in a state of safety with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the next section, Imam al-Ghazali talks about performing the movements in the salah, performing them well. When we go into ruku', when we rise from ruku' and so forth, that we're actually, we're balanced, and we perform those movements with ihsan, and we do so properly. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wasallam said, صلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم, pray as you have seen me pray. So the way that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم prayed, it's very important that we follow that even in the outward movements. نعم. So in a hadith, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وصحبه وسلم, he said, مثل الصلاة المكتوبة كمثل الميزان من أوفى استوفى. The likeness of the obligatory prayer is like a scale. Whoever puts something on the scale, they get a full measure back. Whoever has a balance, then they receive a full measure in return. In other words, that when you're praying, that you do it well so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants you the full reward. نعم. كانت صلاة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم مستوية كأنها موزونة. the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he had such a balance and a composure and a straightness in his prayer, and it was perfectly balanced. Salawatullahi wa salam alayhi. When he would go into ruku', his back would be straight. When he would come up from ruku', he would stand fully up once again. When he would go into sujood, he would fully prostrate himself. And inshallah, we'll learn about those things in Shaykh Yahya's lesson when he talks about the outward dimension of prayer, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. But those things are very important. And then Imam al-Ghazali, even though he's talking about some of the outward aspects, he continues to remind us of ilm al-akhirah. That the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَيْنِ مِنْ أُمَّتِي لَيَقُومَانِ إِلَى الصَّلَاةِ وَرُكُوعُهُمَا وَسُجُودُهُمَا وَاحِدٌ. That there are two men in my ummah who rise to pray, and their ruku' and their sujood are the same. They look the same. وَإِنَّمَا بَيْنَ صَلَاتَيْهِمَا مَا بَيْنَ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. But the difference between their two prayers is like the heavens and the earth. And Imam al-Ghazali says, وَأَشَارَ إِلَى الْخُشُوعِ, indicating their awe, their presence with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the salah. So we should establish the outward form, but we realize that, as Imam al-Ghazali says, this the outward activates the inner. All of this is meant to fulfill our ubudiyah, and that there are meanings, and that there are things, gifts that come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through establishing it properly, the way that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam did. And he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in another hadith narrated by Imam Ahmad, لا ينظر الله عز وجل يوم القيامة إلى العبد لا يقيم صلبه بين ركوعه وسجوده. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah mighty and majestic, does not gaze upon a person on the day of resurrection if they did not straighten their back when they would rise from ruku' and when they would go into sujood, that they would not extend themselves properly in those positions. So this is once again an indication of how we have to pray and how we have to fulfill it properly. وقال صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم من صلى الصلاة لوقتها, whoever prays on time in its appointed time, فأسبغ وضوءها, and performs the wudu well to full completion, and performs the ruku' and sujood properly, and has khushu' that is fitting in the prayer, that prayer then ascends and it is radiant and luminous. And it says to the one who just prayed that prayer, حفظك الله كما حفظتني, may Allah preserve you as you preserved me, keep you well as you took care of me. ومن صلى لغير وقتها, and whoever prays outside of the appointed time and does not perform the wudu well, and does not perform the ruku' and the sujood properly, nor has the proper khushu', then that prayer exits and ascends to the heavens dark and black and says, ضيعك الله كما ضيعتني, may Allah abandon you and leave you like you have left me. حتى إذا كانت حيث شاء الله لفت كما يلف الثوب الخلق فيضرب بها وجهه, until it rises to a particular point, and then that prayer is rolled up just the way that a garment is rolled up, an old garment, and the person is slapped in the face with it. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. And some of the salihin, when they would finish their prayer, they would say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. They would almost be frozen in place. People would get up and do other things, and they would ask, what are you doing? I'm still thinking about whether my prayer has been accepted or not. It's over. The opportunity has passed. Has Allah accepted it? And they would sit there for a while and really ponder the reality of their salah. Has it gone up praying on my behalf, accepted by Allah? Or did I not have the proper adab and etiquette and khushu' in my salah? And maybe it was thrown back in my face. They would think about those things. So we have to be aware in the salah. And all of these ahadith, they help us want to improve. this knowledge of revelation, this sacred knowledge, it brings our hearts to life so that the next prayer that we have, we can bring some of these things to mind, and they help cultivate that khushur, that presence of heart. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. In this section, Imam al-Ghazali now talks about the merit of the congregational prayer. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, that prayer in congregation is superior to a person praying alone by 27 times. In Arabic, daraja, but it means 27 degrees, or it is 27 times better to pray in congregation than to pray alone. And Abu Huraira narrates, radiyallahu anhu, that the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, and this is an intense hadith. This is an intense hadith. But the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was sent as a mercy to the worlds. So when we come across these ahadith that have a degree of majesty, of jalal, and they might even shock us a little bit, it's because the Messenger of Allah wants what's best for us. And he is indicating the severity of not performing this for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Na'am. So he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, there were some people who weren't present at the prayer. So he noticed that. And he said, لَقَدْ هَمَمْتُ أَنْ أَمُرَ رَجْلًا يُصَلِّي بِالنَّاسِ. It came to my mind, I thought about telling another man to lead the prayer. Then I would go to those men who don't come to the salah, and I would burn their houses down. The Messenger of Allah said, one, he didn't do that. He, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he's trying to say, as Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu said, the fire of the akhirah is burning, and the way that we put it out is coming together and praying in congregation. And if people knew how serious and how severe the torment of the hereafter was, they wouldn't think about anything but the salah. Let alone they just get comfortable. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he said that in order for people to realize the importance of praying in congregation. You know, we all go home and we get comfortable and so forth. No, we have to push ourselves because there are so many terrible things of the hereafter that we are protected from through praying in congregation, and beautiful gifts and anwar that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us when we pray in congregation. So we have to make that effort. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever prays salatul isha, it is as if he has prayed half the night, or she has prayed half the night and prayed in congregation. Man shahid al-isha, whoever prays the isha prayer in congregation, it is as if he has prayed half the night. And whoever prays the fajr, the subh salah in congregation, then it is as if the second half of the night has been filled with prayer. فَكَأَنَّمَا قَامَ اللَّيْلَ كُلُّهُ أَوْ فَكَأَنَّمَا قَامَ لَيْلَةً أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. It is as if he has prayed the entire night by praying Salatul Isha in congregation and Salatul Fajr in congregation. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he also said, مَنْ صَلَّى صَلَاةً فِي جَمَاعَةً فَقَدْ مَلَأَ نَحْرَهُ عِبَادَةً. Whoever prays in congregation has filled his chest, has filled his heart with worship. And the muhaqqiqeen, they say that perhaps this is a statement of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, and maybe not a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam directly. That's in the footnote from the Ithaf. Na'am. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, he also said, مَا أَذَّنَ مُؤَذِّنٌ مُنْذُ 20 سَنَةً إِلَّا وَأَنَا فِي الْمَسْجِدِ. This shows the Salaf al-Salih, the pious predecessors, how much they valued the salah. Now, as Shaykh Yahya was saying, that some of the salihin, the way that they would describe their life is waiting for the prayers, praying the five prayers in congregation, and waiting to die. Praying the five prayers in congregation and waiting to die. And people who have met these righteous people, the salihin, the awliya, they see that they're just immersed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's remembrance. And they realize what is important and that the dunya is something very fleeting. So Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, he said, for the last 20 years, whenever the muezzin would call the adhan, I would already be in the masjid. Not waiting to hear the adhan, saying, oh, maybe I'll get there, or I'll get to it later, or after I finish this thing, that some of the salihin were already there. And one of the categories of people who will be shaded on the day of resurrection, when there's no shade save the shade that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants, is a man whose heart was attached to the masajid. And what does that mean? It means that his heart was attached to the salah, salah in jama'ah, waiting for the next salah. When you love someone and you have the opportunity to be with them intimately, oh, I can't wait for the next time. Can't wait for the next opportunity. Oh, when's the next salah? Instead of looking at the salah like, oh, I got so many things to do today. The salah is coming up. The time is short and I have to pray. And it's not, we shouldn't look at it as a burden. We should look at it as the best thing in our lives. Alhamdulillah, I get to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I get to pray and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fulfill my needs. If we thought about the Fatiha, the meanings in the Fatiha, and Shaykh Yahya is going to cover that. Imam al-Ghazali tells us what we should be thinking about in the Fatiha. Every ayah, how we should be, you know, interacting, communicating, having this intimate discourse with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if we're following the imam and hearing it from him, or in a silent prayer, we take into consideration that we are standing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The beautiful thing, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would say, arihna biha ya Bilal. When he would tell him to call the adhan, say, Bilal, give us our comfort. Comfort us. Comfort us with the adhan. Comfort us with the salah. And he said, ju'ilat qurratu ayni fi salah. That of all the things that Allah made beloved to him, that the most beloved thing to him, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, was the salah. La ilaha illallah. Na'am. So this is the way of the salihin, that they would make an effort to be there early. Hatim al-Asam, he said, فَاتَتْنِ الصَّلَاةُ فِي الْجَمَاعَةِ فَعَزَّانِ أَبُو إِسْحَاقَ الْبُخَارِ وَحْدَهِ وَلَوْ مَاتَ لِي وَلَدٌ لَعَزَّانِ أَكْثَرُ مِنْ عَشْرَةِ الْآلَافِ لِأَنَّ مُصِيبَةَ الدِّينِ أَهْوَنُ عِنْدَ النَّاسِ مِنْ مُصِيبَةِ الدُّنْيَا. So Hatim al-Asam, one of the great salihin, he said, I once missed the prayer in jama'ah. So Abu Ishaq al-Bukhari, he came over to offer me his condolences. You know, like when someone passes away, they come over, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Azzam Allahu ajr. I'm sorry. Sorry to hear the tribulation that you're going through. He said, Abu Ishaq al-Bukhari came over and offered condolences. You missed the jama'ah. Do you know what you missed? It's not, nothing in the dunya can replace what was missed. And he said, he was the only one to come and offer me condolences. And had I lost a child, there would be 10,000 people who would offer me condolences. But it's because people think that a tribulation of the religion is less than a tribulation of deen. La ilaha illallah. Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu, he said, لَأَنْ تُمْلَأْ أُذُنَ بْنِ آدَمْ رَصَاصًا مَذَابًا خَيْرٌ لَهُ مِنْ أَنْ يَسْمَعَ النِّدَاءِ ثُمَّ لَا يُجِيبُهُ. Abu Huraira said, for a person to have their ears filled with melted lead, is better than a person hearing the adhan and not responding, not coming to the prayer. Maymun ibn Mahran, he once came to the masjid and people had already completed the prayer and were leaving. So he said, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. La fadlu hadhihi as-salah ahabbu ilayya min wilayat al-Iraq. He said, to Allah we belong and to Allah we are returning. What we say when we face a calamity. He said, the merit of this prayer is more beloved to me than ruling all of Iraq. If I was given the chance of getting the merit of this salah or being the ruler of Iraq, I would choose this salah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam said, whoever prays 40 days, all of the prayers in jama'ah, لا تفوته فيها تكبيرة الإحرام. Saying the opening Allahu Akbar with the Imam, not missing even the opening invocation and entering the opening takbira into the salah. كُتِبَ لَهُ بَرَاءَتَانِ. He will be granted absolvement from two things, that he will be safe and absolved from hypocrisy, and he will be safe from the fire. 40 days praying all the prayers in jama'ah without missing takbiratul ihram, that he will be, it will be written for him that he is safe from hypocrisy and saved from the fire. And in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his city, from the barakah of his city and his masjid sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that it's not 40 days but 40 prayers, so 8 days. So when you go to Medina, try to stay there for at least 8 days and pray all of the prayers in the masjid. Be there before the adhan. There's so many other things you could do at other times. Be there for the adhan and pray 40 prayers, 8 full days in jama'ah, and you will be granted that same reward. Na'am. La ilaha illallah. There's so much to cover, but inshallah we'll just now look at some of the virtues of the masajid, inshallah, and there. The merit of prayer in the mosque. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. That Allah's masajid are maintained and the rights of the masajid are fulfilled by those who believe in Allah and the last day. So it's a sign of iman that a person spends time in the masjid. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, مَنْ بَنَى لِلَّهِ مَسْجِدًا وَلَوْ كَمَفْحَصِ قَطَاهِ بَنَى اللَّهُ لَهُ قَصْرًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever builds a masjid for Allah's sake, even if it's the size of a partridge's nest. It's really interesting, so I googled this. Like, partridge's nest. So actually I found out that partridges are birds that build their nests on the ground. I never even knew that existed. And it's just like a little hole that they build in the ground, and they get some grass and they'll lay their eggs there. But it's like that big. That's how big their nest on the ground is. Because I would always think about this. I'm like, it's nest in the tree. I never fully was able to visualize it. But it's actually a bird that builds its nest on the ground. And it's just a small area, a very small area. So the Prophet ﷺ says, whoever builds a masjid for Allah, even if it's the size of a partridge's nest, Allah will build that person a palace in paradise. وَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهُ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَنْ أَلِفَ الْمَسْجِدَ أَلِفَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. The Prophet ﷺ said, in a hadith narrated by Imam al-Tabarani, whoever becomes intimately familiar with the masjid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala becomes intimately familiar with him. La ilaha illallah. There are so many things to look at, mashallah. He also said, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, al-malaikatu tusalli ala ahadikum ma dama fi musallah alladhi yusalli fih. Taqul Allahumma salli alayhi, Allahumma ighfir lah, Allahumma arhamh, Allah ma lam yahdith aw yakhruj min al-masjid. The angels continue to pray for you as long as you are in the place of your prayer that you prayed in the masjid. The angels say, oh Allah, bless him. Oh Allah, forgive him. Oh Allah, have mercy on him, as long as he does not speak or leave the masjid. And if a person comes early and is waiting for the prayer, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that person will be considered as if they are in the prayer as long as they are waiting for the prayer. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam, I'm just going to choose a few here to end on time, inshallah, also said, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, that Allah Mighty and Majestic said in some of the previous books, revealed books, that my houses on the earth are the mosques, the places of prayer. وَإِنَّ زُوَّارِ فِيهَا عُمَّارُهَا. And those who frequent the mosques are my visitors. So blessed is a servant who purifies himself in his home, then visits me in my house. فَحَقٌ عَلَى الْمَزُورِ أَن يُكْرِمْ زَائِرَهُ. So it is incumbent upon the one being visited that he honors his guest. So when you come to the masjid, it is as if you are Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's guest, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most generous. He will honor you whenever you come to the masjid. Na'am. The Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ الرَّجُلَ يَعْتَادُ الْمَسَاجِدِ فَاشْهَدُ لَهُ بِالْإِيمَانِ. If you see a man who regularly comes to the mosque, then bear witness that he has iman. Bear witness that he is a believer. Na'am. La ilaha illallah. And there are some of the adab in the masajid. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he said, بَشِّرْ الْمَشَّائِينَ فِي الظُّلَمِ إِلَى الْمَسَاجِدِ بِالنُّورِ التَّامِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Give glad tidings to those who walk in the darkness of night to the masajid with a complete, perfect light on the day of resurrection. The hadith sahih narrated by Abu Dawood. Those who go and pray Salatul Isha and Salatul Fajr in the darkness of night, that Allah will grant them a perfect light on the day of resurrection. When people are crossing the Sirat, there will be various levels of darkness and light, that this person will have a complete light around them because of praying Isha and Fajr in the masjid. Na'am. Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu anhu wa karramallahu wajah, he said, إِذَا مَاتَ الْعَبْدُ. When a servant dies, the place where he or she prayed on earth cries for him. And the place where his good deeds are accepted in the heavens and ascend into the heavens cries for him as well. And he recited the verse, فَمَا بَكَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّمَاءُ وَالْأَرْضِ, that the heavens and the earth did not cry for them about people who are disbelievers, but the believers, those places where they would pray and their good deeds would be accepted, cry for them after they pass away. Na'am. And Ibn Abbas said, and that goes on for 40 days, the place where a person prayed. And Ata'un al-Khurasani, he said, any servant who prostrates for Allah, even one prostration, in any place on earth, it will bear witness for him on the day of resurrection, and it will cry for him on the day that he dies. We're almost done. Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik said, مَا مِن بُقْعَةٍ يَذْكُرُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلْ عَلَيْهَا بِصَلَاةٍ أَوْ ذِكْرٍ إِلَّا افْتَخَرَتْ عَلَى مَا حَوْلَهَا مِنَ الْبِقَاعِ. Any piece of land in which Allah, mighty and majestic, is remembered, or a person prays there, or there's any kind of dhikr, that it becomes honored, and it tells of itself to the other areas surrounding it. And it takes glad tidings in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the way through the seven layers of the earth. وَمَا مِنْ عَبْدٍ يَقُومُ يُصَلِّي إِلَّا تَزَخْرَفَتْ لَهُ الْأَرْضِ. And whenever a servant rises to pray, the earth ornaments and adorns itself for that person who prays. Yeah. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us people who establish the salah in its appointed times, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us people who perform each of the movements in the salah and all of the integrals and sunan of the salah properly, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us tawfiq to pray in congregation, and that He accepts our prayers, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us people whose hearts are attached to the masajid, the best of places, and whose hearts are attached to the salah. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والحمد لله رب العالمين والعفو منكم.